Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming. If you're a journalist, we encourage you to come to the first three rows, please, so we can find you. So please come on in, have a seat. Before we start, I just want to mention for this press conference with the U.S. Secretary of Agriculture, Thomas Vilsack, and the chair of the White House Council on Environmental Quality, Ms. Brenda Mallory, that our principals will not go into detailed discussions about the negotiations, and they also are unable to speak on the upcoming plans for the upcoming administration. But they are here to answer your questions, and I think we are ready to get started. So without further ado, let's go.
Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm happy to have a chance to talk a little bit about the great work that the Biden-Harris administration has been doing over the last 4.5 years. As the chair of the White House Council on Environmental Quality, we have been very proud to lead President Biden's conservation agenda over the past 4 years, including the efforts to protect clean water. And I'm grateful to be here today with Secretary Vilsack and for the great partnership that we've had and with his team as well over this period. Together and with the support and engagement of other members of the Biden-Harris administration, we have delivered the most ambitious climate change, clean energy, and conservation agenda in U.S. history, leading the charge for action at home and abroad. During his first days in office, President Biden set a goal to conserve at least 30% of the lands and waters by 2030. And I'm proud to say that we have conserved more than 45 million acres so far, including some of the nation's most treasured places like the Boundary Waters in Minnesota, Bristol Bay in Alaska, and the Everglades in Florida. Through our Investing in America agenda, we have also invested tens of billions of dollars to make our communities more resilient to drought, floods, and other climate impacts, including through nature-based solutions. Our approach centers locally led solutions by offering new tools and resources for communities to advance their own conservation efforts. This work is supported by the communities, and it has momentum. States, cities, and counties globally have committed to their own 30% by 2030 conservation. Excuse me, that's countries globally have committed to their own 30% by 2030 conservation goals. These partnerships are crucial for protecting clean water. At last year's COP in Dubai, I announced that the United States was joining the Global Freshwater Challenge, partnering with 45 countries and the European Union to protect and restore rivers and wetlands worldwide. Since then, the United States launched our own America the Beautiful Freshwater Challenge and established a national goal to protect, restore, and reconnect 8 million acres of wetlands and 100,000 miles of rivers and streams by 2030. To achieve these goals, we are calling on U.S. states, tribes, and local communities, businesses, and others to advance their own policies and strategies for conserving and restoring America's freshwater systems. We purposefully included partners from the private sector, philanthropic entities, and other non-governmental organizations because carrying forward this ambitious goal will require us to deepen existing partnerships and to forge new ones. Today, we have more than 210 members who are part of the challenge. Before we get to questions, I'd like to spend a moment highlighting one other aspect of CEQ's work, and that's federal sustainability. President Biden set a historic goal in the first year that our federal government would achieve net zero emissions by 2050, including a 65% reduction by 2030. We will talk more about how we are meeting this target at the U.S. Center later this week, including partnering with our suppliers and catalyzing markets for cleaner steel and other building materials. So I encourage you to join us. For those of us dedicated to climate action and sustainability, the outcome of the U.S. presidential election is disappointing. But I know that working together in our communities, across industry, and across the globe, we can grow our coalitions, broaden our impact, and reach our goals. I welcome your questions. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon. I want to thank the chair for tremendous partnership and leadership on the 30 by 30 initiative and her understanding of the role of private working lands as well in terms of conservation. It's been a great partnership. You know, we are here today celebrating Food and Ag Day, which I think is started at COP 28 and has continued into COP 29. And I think it's a recognition and of the world understanding the significance of food and agriculture, food systems, in the effort to try to get to 1.5, to preserve that opportunity and the role that food and agriculture can play in that an effort. In solidarity for a green world, the tagline for this particular COP focuses on enhanced ambition and enabled action. And I think it's an opportunity as well for us in the U.S. to focus on the aggressive agenda that the Chair Mallory has just indicated to you, and the urgency of the moment. I think we've experienced in the U.S. Some significant storm activity, which I think underscores the importance of getting action focused on climate. I'm excited about the opportunity here to share with the world the work that has been done by the U.S. in partnership with the UAE in the establishment 4 years ago of our Aim for Climate initiative. This was focused on trying to bring the world together in partnership and collaboration to focus on innovation, to focus on the collaboration and sharing of knowledge and information. When we started this initiative, I think our ambition was pretty modest. We hoped for $4 billion of investment. We hoped for a handful of innovation sprints. And our opportunity was that at least a small number of countries would join this effort. Today, we announced that now Aim for Climate has over 800 partners. 56 countries have joined collaboratively to support the initiative. We announced today as well 52 additional innovation sprints, which brings to a total of 129 innovation sprints that have been identified and are sponsored, if you will, by Aim for Climate. With that partnership and with those innovation sprints, we now have commitments of over $29 billion by our partners in spreading the word and encouraging greater innovation. This has been a tremendous success. We now as well, with the UAE's assistance and help by the Gates Foundation, have an Aim for Scale initiative, which is going to allow many of these innovations to scale up. And just today, at an event that I just came from, the U.S. announced a continued commitment to this effort in the sense that we are investing in a number of these innovation sprints. The total collective investment from the U.S. In this effort is over $4 billion, $4.3 billion. We just announced an $80 million commitment to Atlas Agro. It's one of our sprint partners. It is a company that is going to build the first hydrogen facility that will produce fertilizer without increasing the agricultural footprint of that production. It will be a first of its kind in the world, and it will be located in the state of Washington in the Pacific Northwest. We issued a report in September as part of the United Nations gathering in which we outlined the progress that Aim for Climate has made. And we also pointed out the need for continued action. The report contained four recommendations. And the opportunity for countries to include in their NDCs the inclusion of climate smart agriculture and food systems, the need to normalize this $29 billion of investment so that it becomes part of the budgets, if you will, of the private sector, the nonprofit sector, and also governments, The opportunity for us to continue to build global partnerships and to scale public-private partnerships, critically important to this effort. So excited about the progress to report there. Also very proud of the work that the Biden-Harris administration has done domestically in the U.S., as well as the opportunity to share the information we get from these initiatives with the rest of the world. We were proud to launch several years ago with a $3 billion commitment, the Climate Smart Agriculture and Forestry Commodity Partnership Initiative. This is 135 contracts entered into between the USDA and a wide variety of partners, major retailers, food companies, major commodity groups, significant environmental and conservation organizations, working collaboratively together to provide and to promote climate smart practices, nearly 200 of which have been identified in this initiative, over nearly 100 commodities that are grown and raised in the U.S., all 50 states. Proud to say that at the launch of this last year, we began to encourage farms to participate in this effort. And today we announced that over 21,000 farms are engaged and involved in this effort, over 5 million acres committed to it. And that number is growing by significant numbers as we speak. 276 not-for-profit organizations engaged in this effort, 257 for-profit organizations as partners, 98 colleges and universities and minority-serving institutions, and 71 state, local, and tribal governments engaged in this initiative. To underscore the point the chair made about the fact that this is not just federal initiatives, this is happening at state level, it's happening at the local level. We're excited about the opportunity for that. It complements the President's vision outlined in the Inflation Reduction Act, in which the USDA is receiving resources to provide additional conservation spending and investment for farmers, ranchers, and producers. An historic level of investment never before seen in the U.S. or for that matter anywhere. Now over $6 billion at work, another $7.7 billion committed this year. We have over 28,000 farms now receiving the benefit of these Inflation Reduction Act resources, tens of millions of acres now engaged in climate smart conservation practices. This marries with it an effort at clean energy. The President's vision was to create a U.S. that embraced clean energy, an $8.3 billion investment in transforming our rural electric co-ops into clean energy. Our forestry service, our Forest Service engaged as well in reducing the risk of catastrophic wildfire with significant investments in better forest health, protecting 550 communities, several thousand miles of power lines that crisscross our forests, 1,800 watersheds protected, and also a historic and initial investment in urban forestry, 385 projects receiving over $1 billion of assistance to plant more trees. So these are three initiatives, the Climate Commodity Partnership Initiative, the IRA, Conservation, Clean Energy, and Forestry Commitment, and the AIM4C on an international scale. All of this information and the results from all of this will be shared with the world through our International Climate Hub, which was also an offshoot of the Aim for Climate effort. So a lot to talk about and commitments from everyone to continue this work well into the future. So happy to be here and look forward to answering questions.
My name is Lamia Shirinova, APA News Agency. My question is to Thomas Vilsack. Can you share your thoughts on the prospect of agricultural cooperation between Azerbaijan and United States?
The opportunity tomorrow to have a chance to meet with the Minister of Agriculture here. I think there's a terrific opportunity for us to utilize the significant role that this country plays in east-west trade. There's an opportunity for us to work to
create a frictionless capacity of goods to travel from east to west and west to east. There are tremendous opportunities and markets, and I think this country can play a very integral role in connecting east and west. So that's one area I think of significance. The agricultural economy here is relatively small. This is an energy producing country, and so most of its focus is on energy production, but I think we can also be good partners as there is a continued effort to sort of balance the portfolio here by embracing renewable energy. Much of the lessons that we've learned in the U.S. in expansion of clean energy can also be, I think, a topic of conversation and discussion.
Hi, thank you. Zach Coleman with Politico. My question is for Chair Mallory. You know, at the COP, we talk a lot about climate justice. It's one of the bigger topics here every year. You've also pursued justice at the Biden administration with the Justice 40. I'm wondering what steps are you taking to protect that work going forward, given the change in administration?
Thank you, Zach. Appreciate that question. I think the key to the president's whole agenda when it comes to what we call environmental justice, but more broadly to justice, is recognizing the key that we are trying to ensure that clean air, clean water, and healthy environments are part of all of our programming, and that's really what most of the program has been built on. And so, you know, a number of things that have happened already, similar to what the Secretary was talking about in the ag area, there are a number of grants and dollars that have already gone out to communities that are related to kind of clean energy, cleaning up of legacy pollution, making sure that old oil and gas wells and mines are capped. Those activities have already occurred. Dollars have already gone out to those communities. Our whole effort that is around clean school buses and transit vehicles, all of those efforts are actually underway. Dollars have gone to those communities. They're very much focused on communities often that have been underinvested in. So I think on the funding side that is really a critical part of the agenda. On the rulemaking efforts that we've undertaken that are very much focused on the impacts to communities from things like PFAS and from lead and from other toxins, creating environmental plans that are designed to help those communities to make sure that they know what impacts they're exposed to. All of those things, I think, are underway. Some of those will surely continue. And I think then for the institutionalization, which we were very focused on in the White House, just creating really a cultural change in the way that not only the federal government thinks about how you provide environmental protection to communities, but also how our partners in the communities, in states, in local governments, the questions they ask themselves about the impact that their activities are going to have on communities. I think that does not change, right? I think it's one of those things where it's like you can't unring that bell. People understand now that there are broad differences in the way that different communities across the country are experiencing the environmental protection benefits that we offer. And I think that people will want to continue to ask those questions.
My name is Palvana Bayramova. I am from Voice of America and TUAN News Agency. My question is, what's the most serious threats agriculture ecology in the world today? And it's possible to assume that a significant part of food products harmful to people in one way or another. And what needs to be done to prevent in use of GMO? And what about is any cooperation in Azerbaijan in these issues?
I had a hard time hearing the question. I think you were asking about biotechnology and genetically modified. I would say there's a couple of issues here. First of all, the reality is that the world population continues to grow rather dramatically. And that encourages us to look at the tremendous challenge that the food and agriculture system will have to feed the world's population. If indeed it does get to 10 billion people, which it is projected to get to in a relatively short period of time, that is going to require a significant increase in the amount of agricultural production today. Even if we do a much better job of reducing food loss and waste, we're still going to have to produce more, and to produce more at a rate much greater than we have in the past. So you're going to have to use innovation, you're going to have to use science to figure out how to do more with less. It would be a tough enough challenge on its own, but then when you put it in the context of a changing climate, which makes it much more difficult, with weather conditions being what they are, with droughts lasting not months, but years and decades, with storms wiping out and reoccurring, as we've seen in the Southeast and in the United States recently, that places a great deal of pressure. I think we have seen a transition from genetically modified challenges or strategies to gene editing, which is a slightly different mechanism for providing greater resilience, for providing greater opportunities for productivity, for increasing and enhancing ways in which crops can be grown in less ideal conditions, drought-free, drought-resistant crops, for example, things of that nature. So I think the challenge here is for us to make sure that there's an understanding of the science, to give consumers the ability to know what they're purchasing, to have clear transparency, and also to continue to ensure that that technology is available not just to those who can afford it, but to smallholder farmers as well. And then people can make choices. The market can make choices. I think when you create restrictions, then you obviously limit choice. When you limit choice, you impact competition, you impact cost and the affordability and availability of technologies, and that creates problems, particularly for those who are small and mid-sized operations. So continue to finance the development, continue to promote transparency and consumer awareness, continue to look at ways in which science can help us produce more with less. And to try to avoid, if possible, restrictions that are not science-based, that are not not consistent with a risk-based international system, which means there's a place for GMOs for some, but not for all. There's a place for gene editing for some, but not for all. There's a place for a livestock industry, but with an understanding we've got to contain and control methane production. There's a place for plant-based proteins. There's a place for cell culture proteins being produced. We're going to need it all. And I think we don't have the luxury of saying it's this or that. I think it's we have an imperative that we have to encourage all forms, because the challenge is pretty significant. And if we are not able to meet that challenge, the strife, the conflict, the chaos that can ensue will be pretty dramatic.
Hi, thanks for doing this. I'm Tharna Noor at The Guardian. This question is for Secretary Vilsack. Wondering if you could speak a little bit about what can be done in the coming weeks to secure the Biden administration's legacy when it comes to conservation and agriculture specifically.
Well, I think it's what's been done over the last 4 years that provides confidence. It isn't going to be the Biden administration that continues this. It's going to be the people who have received the benefit of the Biden administration that are who understand the significance of what we've invested in, and it's in their self-interest and best interest to preserve it and to continue it. I just had an opportunity to talk to a group of farmers from the U.S. Following a conversation about AIM for Climate, and we were talking about the Climate Smart Commodity Initiative, which these producers are engaged in. They become the advocates. They become the educators of policymakers, suggesting that it would not be in the best interest of an administration or in the country's interest for us to end that opportunity. Frankly, the funding is available. It's already been committed. It's already out there. Contracts have been signed. Obligations have been formed. Partnerships have been expanded. People, as I indicated, 21,000 farms engaged in. That number grows dramatically every month. So there's a groundswell, a momentum that I don't think an incoming administration, regardless of its attitudes about climate or whatever, would be in a position to stop. There is also the issue of the Inflation Reduction Act resources. And in that sense, I think there's a growing consensus on the part of policymakers in Congress that there's a genuine desire to preserve that funding within agriculture. Now, they may preserve it in a slightly different method by incorporating it into a five-year farm bill, but it's still going to be preserved. They still see the benefit of it. And for that matter, a good part of it has been obligated. A good part of it has already been invested. So again, I think the recipients of this conservation resource, the RECs, the rural electric cooperatives, they are really excited about this opportunity to transition and to balance their portfolio from fossil fuel-based generation to more renewable energy. They see the wisdom of it. Why? Because it's going to be less cost for their customer. It's going to be lower cost electricity. Who's not in favor of that? So they will basically drive and educate and say, no, this is something you want to continue. And for that matter, you want to take credit for it because it's going to be constructed in your administration. I mean, that's the interesting trick that takes place with administration. Sometimes you have to assume the bad of a previous administration. If the economy was tough, as the Biden-Harris administration embraced an economy that was in the tank and build it back up, the new administration may get the benefit of a very healthy economy right now. They also may get the benefit of being present when so many of these projects come to fruition and people begin to see what the Biden-Harris administration started. So I'm confident that this is going to continue, just because I think the people who are receiving the benefits understand it's their responsibility to preserve it.
Thank you all. That's all we have time for. Thank you for coming.